so much for the opportunity to once again gather. We thank you for, Father, allowing us to be here to honor you. Father, we pray that the things we do and sing and say today will be those that are pleasing to you. Father, just be with us this morning. Join with us. We pray this in your Son's name.
All right, everybody stand.
Your hands in the hand of the man who called the sea.
splendor of the King, both in majesty and all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. How great is our God? Sing to me, how great.
I get to do this today because I didn't hand out the list of who was the next in line. That will happen today. No. Wanted to read to you from the book of John. And it's chapter 1, start with verse 1. And it says these words, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning." I mean, sometimes I think we forget that. I think we come to communion time and we think of his life and his burial and his resurrection, and we forget that Jesus always was. And he saw what went on throughout mankind. And he saw God's plan and knew God's plan. And yet, he came. What a thought, if you knew what was going to happen to you in the next year, and you saw tragedy, how many of you would go into it? How many of you would try to change where it was going? I remember reading Jesus in the garden. I remember him sweating blood drops. I remember him saying, "If there's any other way," he knew exactly what was going to take place. And he thought, "If there's any other way, but not my will, yours be done." How many times do we use that phrase in our lives? "Father, I want this, but not my will. Yours be done." And because his will was done, because Jesus went to the cross and paid the price for us, today we gather at this table to remember that. We gather to take the juice and the loaf and to remember the body and blood that was broken and shed for us. And in our lives should emulate what he did. But not my will, Father, yours in my life. Because of this, because of my commitment to you, not my will, yours. So this morning we're going to clear our minds, we're going to clear everything, we're going to think just on Jesus. We're going to think about what brings us to this point. What was done for us that we're here. See if we can't commit ourselves to his will because of his act. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you this morning for the opportunity that we have, Father, to come to the foot of the cross, to the base of your throne, to sit with you, to remember your Son, Father, to commune with you this morning, that we know what it took. We know that we are not righteous or no, we're not worthy. Father, you make us worthy through your Son, through this act. And Father, this morning we come to remember that, to commemorate it, to say to you, not our will, but yours be done because of him. Father, just bless the cup, bless the loaf, bless those who partake. Pray this in your Son's name. Amen. Every time I think of offering, you hear the word offering or tithes, you think of the money, the things that we can give, that we've worked for, that we've earned in our lives to give back. And this morning, as I was contemplating this morning, what do you say, what do you make that's different today that spurs them to be joyful givers, as the word says, to give to God joyfully what you have? And a picture came to my mind. Sometimes I just want to stand in the offering plate. The picture of giving all. My talents, my abilities, my time, whatever it takes, God, to do your work in this kingdom. We know it takes money. But it also takes people, talents, efforts, and things to make a difference in people's lives. I mean, this morning, as you give of your monies to Him, consider giving of yourself to others, that they might come to a saving knowledge of Him and be here with us. You know, to give of those things, I don't like dwelling on money and doing money. We've been together 20 years, and once have I done a sermon on money and tithing. I think that if you're with God and you're His and He's living through you, you know what He wants, you know what it costs, and you're a joyful giver doing that, but we always leave out that of ourselves. To stand in the offering plate and say, here's my offering. Do with it what you will. Again, not my will, yours be done, Father, in life, as you see fit. So this morning, as we prepare to give, the plates are at either side, giving here or at home, if you want to send it, or however you're going to do that to make sure that you're giving. I mean, do that as a joyful giver to God, giving to Him for His purpose and His will. Let's pray. Father, once again, we thank you for life itself. Father, we thank you for talents and abilities and just the many things that you give us on a daily basis. Father, we want to take this time to give back to you. Yes, it's our monies and our abilities that we've earned it with to give to you, but Father, it's also us to be the stewards to use it, to build your kingdom, bring those that are lost into a saving grace with you. Father, just bless those who are giving, bless the gifts. We pray this all in your Son's name.
Thank you.
verse. It'll be all over the place. So, but Isaiah chapter 43 will be our key verse area. Isaiah 43. How many of you like your past? Like your past?
P-A-S-T.
P-A-S-T. How many of you like your P-A-S-T?
Some of it.
A-C-Y-A. How many of you like your middle school years?
Love it.
You don't get to like them now.
How many of you like your high school years?
Oh, great.
Early adulthood. When you look at it, I mean, are there areas of your past you wish never existed?
No, the name is literally
there. Oh, there's parts. Cindy says no, she likes them all.
I need to like all of them.
Made her who she is today.
Cindy used to run the sermon.
Yeah.
Let's go home. But what about the rest of us?
But I can think of parts of my life I'm thinking, gosh, if I hadn't done that, or if I hadn't gone there, or if I haven't, how different would life be? So, in Isaiah chapter 43, we're going to start with verse 16. Verse 16. Starts off, this is what the Lord says. He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters, who drew out the chariots and horses, the army and reinforcements together, and they now lay there, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. The wild animals honor me and the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the desert and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen, and the people I formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise. Now there the author saying, don't you see the past? He's reminding him, I brought you through the Red Sea. I drew out the chariots and the horses and all the armies to me, and then I laid waste of them. Never to rise again. They're done. He said, but don't live in the past, because I'm creating a future. I'm creating streams and stuff in the wastelands for you. Now, Satan wants you to live in the past. There are opportunities that you're going along and all of a sudden something hits in your head and you're thinking, and that past comes up. That's not by mistake. Scripture says he's crafty, he's wise, he's manipulative. He knows exactly what it's going to take bring you down. He knows what it's going to take to slow you down, to hold you back. He even knows what it will take to possibly make you quit. Any of you ever done that? Look back, grab hold. We know Lot's wife. What was the penalty for looking back? Get assaulted. Done. Gone. I mean, there's examples throughout Scripture. When you put your hands to the plow, don't look back. What's the point of that? Create a straight furrow. You know, straight path. Don't look back. Don't look to side to side. Don't just do it. Now, in this room, I believe most of you, all of you, I'm going to go there. I think all of you have put your hand to the plow. meaning you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you have made a commitment, a vow to Him to do this. What is it we do? Oh, you got to say it loud.
We got to go on after the teaching, preaching.
Go ye therefore to all the world, teaching, preaching, baptizing. We have to live the commitment. Don't raise your hands. Don't make yourself look bad. Just think on these words. How are you doing on that commitment? How are you doing on what He asked? Are you going, therefore, into all the world, teaching, preaching, and baptizing? Are you living the life that He has designed for you, not you? See, we can't live in the past. The past is what?
Gone.
Over. History. We now have to live in the future. Philippians 3, 12 to 14. Says, I don't mean to say that I have already achieved these things or that I have already reached perfection, but I press on to possess that perfection for which Christ Jesus first possessed me. No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. I don't any longer look back at the past. The past is gone. Cindy's correct. The past has made us what we are today, but it's got to be gone. I've learned from my mistakes to bring me to where we are today. And now I need to look forward to what Christ has in store for me. So the past is gone. What about the future? How many of you believe in the future? Anybody here have a future?
I hope.
We hope. You have hope for a future. God gives us that. When we're in our past, we can see how God has disciplined us. Anyone here ever been disciplined? We can go in the Bible and we can read stories of people who were disciplined. The Israelite nation, I mean, just follow them through. Discipline, love God, love something else. Discipline, love God, love something else. And we like to make fun of them. Or say, gosh, why don't they get it? And we have to look at us. We have to look at us. We have to look at us. We have to look at the United States. I mean, why don't we get it? Any of you ever read about it? Have you read that God loved you so much that He sent His Son that you might have salvation, that you might be redeemed? You've read that, right? And what does it take to be redeemed? To accept that Son? And when you accept the Son, you accept the job title that goes with it. The go ye therefore. I mean, it's all there spelled out for us. This is bad, but when's the last time did you go? And if we, His people, aren't going, how can we expect them to follow? So we do it wrong. We do it different than we ought to. Hebrews 12:11. We do not enjoy being disciplined. It is painful at the time, but later, after we have learned from it, we have peace because we start living the right way. Now, I don't know about you, but in our family, when I was growing up, we did not spare the rod and spoil the child. We had the wooden spoon. We had the fly swatter. Oh, we had the Easter ball and paddle when the ball came off. We had the willow switch.
Sounds like you had what was ever handy.
We had the belt. We had the bar of soap. We had the concoction. I would take anything but the concoction. And I remember one time I said, "Dagnabbit." And my dad's words were, "Close enough." And he made the concoction. And I wasn't the only one who said it. So did my older brother and my older brother. Where did I learn it from? And so there was three of us lined up in the bathroom, and my dad took these cups, and he went to the medicine cabinet, took a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and this, and he said, "Okay, you can leave when it's gone." By as you should have seen him that day. It's like, what? And he gave us those cups and he said, "Drink." Now I'm sure that my dad knew exactly what he put in that cup, and that was nothing harmful. It tasted harmful. It went down harmful. It came back up harmful. And it was all to teach us that that doesn't come out of here. That we don't do that kind of thing because we have changed. We have been made different. We are. Lessons that we learned. Read it. Read what it says. We do not like being disciplined. It is painful at the time, but later, after we have learned it, we have peace because we start living the right way. My mom and dad did things that tried to direct us, tried to lead us, tried to guide us the correct way. Now, I never understood it when sometimes my mom would go to spank us and she'd be crying. "What are you crying about?" "I'm the one feeling it." No, she felt it. She felt it. When God disciplines us, it's because we did something wrong. He feels it. We're His children. We're His people. And so the past is there to direct us, as Cindy said, to where we are today. And looking at a future. What's that future? Psalms 31, 14 through 16. "But I am trusting you, O Lord, saying, 'You are my God. My future is in your hands. Rescue me from those who hunt me down relentlessly. Let your favor shine on your servant in your unfailing love. Lord, rescue me.'" My future, it says right there, lies in His hands. And I have to learn to trust God that future is better than anything I can come up with. Better than anything I can come up with. We have to trust that. That God has good in mind for us. That He has a future in mind that will take us beyond. God trusts us putting me in front of this room is a lot of trust on his behalf. And he trusts that what I'm going to say are those things that he would say, or that he is saying through me, or through his word, so that you can understand what he wants. Today, if you don't dwell on the past, look forward to the future. But you can't have a future without a present. 2 Corinthians 5:13 through 15. Our firm decision is to work from this focused center. One man died for everyone. That puts everyone in the same boat. He included everyone in his death so that everyone could also be included in his life, resurrection of life, and a far better life than people ever lived before. That's the message version, if you get it. He put us all in one place. The act that we celebrate at the communion table every week is that act that we're talking about. That he said, okay, I'm going to die for Becky and Jeff. Spencer, if he gets it. Robin, you're out. Bruce, don't count. No, he didn't go through and do that, did he? He said, I'm dying for all of you. For all of you. For all your sins. For all the times you thought you could do it yourself. For all the mistakes. For everything. I'm going to die for you. And when you look at it that way, that's pretty personal, isn't it? I mean, Ken, he died for you. I remember my youth minister saying when we were young growing up, he said, imagine this. If you were the only person left in the world, and sin was there, Jesus would have died for you. That's how personal it is. And so in this present time, he says, I'm going to live for him. I'm going to trust him. And that's a daily trust. That's an hourly trust. That's in each moment of life as I go through, as I do, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to think about things. I'm going to make decisions, but I'm going to try and make those decisions based on you. Now, God made a decision based on us. He did. You see it in Genesis chapter 3 when he says that one will come to crush the head of the serpent, the snake. The snake will bite at his heel, but ultimately he's going to win. And we have the word today that we can read through and we can see it played out. We can see the struggle from that point on of God trying to have his people love him. His people serve him. And we're lucky. We can look to the past in the Old Testament and see it. And we can see these great servants of God fail. And when we talk about a couple of them in Sunday school, we talk about, David, this great king, this great warrior, this kid who goes out and slays the giant, the stories of his life, his devotion to his friend John, just everything through the stories. And Jeff said, it's amazed me that he sent a man to battle knowing he would be killed so he could have his wife. That's a great king. It's a servant of God. And that story's there, gang, so that we can see that when we blow it, when we don't do it right, God, us and cares for us. David's story, restored. Abraham, rushing it, taking a servant to have a child, restored. Go through the scriptures and look at the stories that are there, because they're there for us to learn from the past. Not to live in the past, to learn from the past. To see what they had to be disciplined for and learn from, so that we won't make the same mistakes. If you don't study it, you're going to do it. And the punishment they got will be your punishment. We can't think that we're any different. And then he said, enough. The whole story from Genesis 3 was building up the Gospels. And to that person, Jesus, who in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was there from the beginning, waiting for his Father to change the world, and he changed the world through him. And now, as we presently live, we know that Jesus lives too. And we know that as we live, he lives sitting next to the right-hand side of his Father, and he waits. And he anticipates those words. That day when God says, go get him. That God who loves us enough to send his Son is going to send him again. That's our future. That's what we anticipate. Just as Jesus sits there doing his thing, ruler of all, as he sits there and does his, he waits for the Father to say, go. And here we are, living in the present, and we're not much different, are we? How many of you anticipate his return? How many of you can't wait till the Father says, go? How many of you realize that when he says go, God wins? And assuredly as I stand here, I'm going to tell you this, I win. Because he's my God, my Lord, my Savior. Don't let your past determine your future, because you'll never get to where we are today. Don't let your past determine your future, because you'll never get where he wants you today. When the devil tries to keep you looking at your past, it must mean there is something great in your future he doesn't want you to see. And as long as you live in your past, you'll not see it. Learn from the past and let the past be the past. Live in the present, looking for that future. Looking for that home in glory. Awaiting him to say, go. Man, I'm going to be totally honest with you. I'm ready. I'm not afraid of it. I'm ready. But, do I want it to be today? See, part of our future is that we have dreams and aspirations, don't we? I mean, I got a daughter that was just here this weekend, got to see her for a day before she took back off. And you know, the dreams and aspirations of what's her future and what does it hold and what's she going to do. And I have a son that came screaming in the driveway this morning from work to see her before she left. And what's his future? You know, I know he doesn't like the job he's in. It's a job, and he's going to do it. He's going to keep working until he finds something else. But it's not a career. It's a job. And what is his life going to be like? And I've got a son and daughter-in-law who are out this weekend on this little island, Driftwood Island, getting pictures taken of them because they're going to have a baby. And in a couple months, I'll be a grandfather if all things hatch out right. You know, and to see what that is and what that's like, and to be, you know, those things. I'm ready. God, if you want to come today, okay, but I have these dreams and aspirations of what life can be. And I don't just have dreams and aspirations of that. I got dear friends who would be lost. Lost. If you came back today. Just thinking of them, I mean, kills me. So Lord, if you could tarry one more day, give me one more chance. That's the thing that really drives me, is there are people who don't know Jesus Christ. And I used to be like them, and in my past I used to be like them. I used to be this, whatever. Let's enjoy it. Let's go. And we come to a point where we find that saving grace, and now life is all about it. And I want them to know it. So Lord, if you want to come today, that's great, but if you can give me another day to speak to talk to say something, to send something, to whatever it takes to get them to look at you. That's living in the present, that's doing it today, because we're not promised tomorrow. So what about you? What's your driving force? I mean, I've shared my driving force is the people. Those close friends, those other people. I mean, it's those people maybe I haven't met yet that need him. It's Pete the fireman who ran into the towers, who's living down here now, who's fighting cancer of the throat, who's doing things. And if I could one more time talk to him. He was going to be here last week. He was going to be here this week. One more time to talk to him and maybe get him next week. What's your driving force? Name it. I mean, I give you names. I give you Don. I give you Ted. I give you Frank, the fireman. I can go on and on. I mean, I can go to a Bible study tonight. Isn't that sad? That I can name those people that need Jesus in their lives, that have been in my life, that I need a little more time to reach them. So name your driving force in your head. Name it. Who's on your list that needs Jesus? That needs to get out of their past, into their present, and looking for their future. Who is it that needs Jesus today? Today, not tomorrow, for their life. That's what this whole sermon is about, is us getting it right, that us living it right, us doing it right so that we can make others right. Not because of us, but because they see Jesus in us. Because they see how we live in the present. And I got people to tell you, man, you've got a great future ahead of you. I know I do. I got streets of gold. I got the light of the world to sit and talk to for an eternity. And my future is bright. What about yours? What about those that are your driving force? We're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation. It's an opportunity for you to look at your life. Not just here, but are you living the commitment you made? Are you His? Is it His will or your will? That's a struggle in life. We want to do it our way when there's His way. So we're going to stand, we're going to sing, and if you have a choice to make for Him, a first-time choice, if there's someone here that hasn't, I mean, we want to offer that to you, that you can be His. Moreover, we want those of you that are here, that are His, to take a close look at you. Are you going into the world, teaching, preaching, baptizing? Are you making a difference in people's lives because of Him? Can He trust you with His word, with His Son, to give to others? So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to stand, we're going to sing, and if you have a decision to make, whether it's a first-time decision or a 100th time in your life, I mean, make a decision to be His, to do His will and His work. Let's stand and sing. Whether that's a day or a year. Father, help us to reach those that we know. that needs you. Father, guide our steps, guide our words. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.